Do it again.
Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world.
You're listening to Drinks, Jokes, and Storytelling.
A martini, shaken, not stirred.
Don't try and church it up, son.
You can't handle the truth.
I am big. The picture that got small.
Your first one's on us.
Hey, welcome to Drinks, Jokes, and Storytelling. I'm your host, Mark Rigadana, and with me, as always,
Richie Byrne.
The dancing Richie Byrne. The dancing. He got
and
the
I
circus.
Get the point right, which I'm
you did get the point right. Boom.
Boom. Boom. How are you?
I'm good, man. How are you doing?
I'm okay. We had a killer show last night.
That was a lot of fun, man. Vic, it was great catching up with Vic.
If you haven't seen it, go watch it. Vic DiBattista was wonderful.
Yeah, actually, go back and listen to all 79 other episodes.
Yeah, this is episode 80, baby.
180, that's wild.
There is talk, and by talk, I mean me and you, that we're going to do something very special for the 100th.
Yes.
For the 100th episode, probably do something special. And it looks like we probably can get away with it because I think we're going to be stuck for a little while longer. What do you think?
Yeah. What did you just say? They said May 15th?
I'm hearing May 15th now. Yeah.
Well, but, that's my calendar's been cleared up to June 1st. So I'm okay with May 15th.
All right.
Speaking of talking about the virus, my home state did something I think is pretty cool, and I want to show it to you. My home state, Ohio, made a kind of a little, I guess you could say, a morale video, a little safety video, something to get people excited. And we have it. So we're going to air that now, and I want to get your take on it.
All right.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 feet apart. Stay home. Stay home. How's about we coordinate it?
We're gonna do it. Give us any cure, we'll take it. Offer us your hand, we'll shake it. We're gonna make those people through. Doing it all right. Nothing's gonna make us work now. Cause we're flattening the curve now. We're gonna see us people through. Doing it all right. See at the end, it says on the bottom of the credits, it says, "With God, all things are possible."
Oh, it's Ohio.
Religion and politics.
Have you been to Ohio?
There's got to be one atheist in Ohio who's pissed off about that. Do you know what's funny about that cartoon is? I'm like, it's bad and good all rolled up into one. Like, I don't know what to make of it.
You just described Ohio.
Well, I do think it's funny that you would come from a state that has a governor who has wine in his name.
I mean, that's legit, right?
It's like governor of wine. His name's DeWine.
Well, I guess Governor Drunk Whiskey was taken. So. In that video, my favorite part is when they go to cut and they show the skyline. It's so true to Ohio fashion. There's only one building. Zoom in on the one building.
Who's the guy dancing? Do you even know who that is?
I don't know who it is, but it cracks me up every time they show up.
Because that's supposed to be Carmine.
Yeah. Which, ironically, that was my nickname in high school, the Big Ragu.
Oh, the Big Ragu, really? Eddie Mecca. Shout out to Eddie Mecca. Now, here's the thing about that is that it's a great idea, but it's a dumb idea, but it's not, I can't figure out what, do you think it helps? Do you think people go, oh, I saw the cartoon, the Laverne and Shirley cartoon.
I think it's a...
Does anyone from Generation Z have any idea what that's from?
Probably not. But I feel like it's a little bit of a morale thing. It's a little bit of a...
I really think they should have let Milwaukee do it. But...
Well, Ohio doesn't have Milwaukee in it.
I'm
so.
Saying that that's, Milwaukee was where that took place. You know,
I'm wondering... I would love to do the research and find out. I wonder if it's like a college did it. Like, you know, that does animation or something.
Maybe. Maybe.
And it was just kind of a fun project to...
I mean, it obviously wasn't Disney.
I thought it was also really funny when they showed the girl with the bat looking out, and she thought she saw the coronavirus through the peephole, and then opened it up, and it's fucking the Buckeye.
I'm like, what is that? Oh, now like I gotta watch it. Like, this is gonna be like a Kubrick film. I'm gonna go back and watch it.
Only to you, Richie. Everyone else got it the first time. You go back and you're like, oh my god, if you watch it a second or third time, you find new things.
So that was very interesting.
It was a lot of fun, you know,
scary but fun. I don't know. Do you know who that doctor is? Is she like a local?
She was in all the. I saw a lot of when everything first hit. Ohio was kind of ahead of everything. Like as soon as, and people were pissed at DeWine. I mean, people were like, "How dare he shut down?
Really?
How dare he tell people to stay home? Who does he think he is?" And then the rest of the country started doing it, and it was like. And then I was like, how dare he shut schools down? And then the rest of the country did it. And they're like, Mike DeWine was a good guy. Mike DeWine was at, they were ready to murder him. I don't know much about him. I don't know his politics. I don't even know what side of the aisle he's on.
Yeah.
But I, you know, on Facebook, I see all my friends bitching about him and then bragging about how they were ahead of the curve.
That's funny. hold on. I'm just looking him up. Mike DeWine. I'll tell you in a minute. Yeah, I mean, okay. Well, I want to. I'm wasting time. Sorry.
Yeah,
we'll fix this in post.
Well, yeah, we'll fix this in post. We're live.
He's Republican.
He's a Republican. Republican. Well, that's probably one of the main reasons people were bitching about him. And yeah, if you would have said Democrat, I would have said the same exact punchline.
I got you. This is a great show today, man. We got a great guest.
Yes, we have a. This is a very special episode. Very special guest.
Very old friend.
Take it away, Richie. This is your buddy.
I've been friends with this guy since 19, and he's a really good friend. I love him to death. We have a clip for him.
We're
going to bring him out, so let's watch the clip.
I've been up to a lot of things since trading spaces. I opened a restaurant in central Illinois near where I'm from. I spent a lot more time there than I thought, but it was a great experience. I took an old building, completely gutted it, and designed and built it back up.
How about that?
Yeah.
Designed it, built it. That's my man.
Right there.
And cooked and cleaned and did whatever, and he's here for us today. Give it up for my good friend, Doug Wilson, ladies.
Doug Wilson's in the house.
Hello. Hey, Richie.
Hi.
Mark, how are you?
Good, man. It's great to have another Midwestern voice on.
Yeah.
What do you mean? What do you fucking mean?
I know. I swear to God, I get swore at more than when I go home and visit my parents.
Doug, do you like the design behind me? Do you like
me? No, not at all. And Mark's is even worse.
Yeah.
Do you like that? Oh, you can't see it. I have a panic button. That's
oh no, I didn't see it.
Do you like my name? Do you see my name?
I just when you guys were talking, I just saw the bacon breast.
Doug used to call me bacon breast.
Well, here's how it happened. Richie and I. Okay, My God. Okay, we toured in this show, None for the Road. Okay. Yes. And I came on, and let me just say, the first day when I was on set, we were changing. We did the show in high schools and junior highs all around the country.
It was a tour of high schools, yeah.
Yeah. And it was on DWI, Drinking and Driving. So anyway.
Richie was the before?
Ironically.
So I replaced someone, and I come on, and I didn't know Richie at all. I didn't know his background. I've got four brothers. He's got three brothers, you know, and, you know, he's wised off and said something to me.
No.
And I just punched him right in the freaking arm. I mean, it was just instinct, you know, you son of a bitch. Bam. and then we bonded over that, I think.
Yeah, we did. I was like being a smartass, right, about something, and he just punched me, fucking hit me.
Well, you have to understand also that
Richie brings that out of people.
The people that had the role before me were maybe a little light in their loafers, you know. So but, Richie,
yeah, because you're such a man.
Well, compared to Trixie Trixel.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah, okay. But anyway, I think Richie just, you know, was used to, you know, being able to push people around. And I'm like, no, that ain't flying with me.
That's true at all.
I want you to know that I came prepared.
Yeah, what are you drinking? What are you drinking?
I got a Dutch craft vodka. I'm looking for an endorsement sponsorship deal. So I've got that. I've got my mixers.
Okay.
I've got my ice bucket. And
Richie, this is a friend of yours.
I've got a sandwich just in case. Because I don't know how long this bullshit's going to go on.
Doug, it's less than an hour. The show is less than an hour. And we asked you to be on a show, not go fucking camping for the weekend.
Yeah, I never know with you. You know. Yeah, Richie can
be worth the camp.
I've been a captive, you know, audience of Richie's for years. When we were traveling in that show, we had to listen to his damn routine constantly because we were in a car. We were all in a car together.
You're so full of shit right now.
And no, I guarantee, even if this was in the 19 whatever year you were saying,
it was the 80s. Yeah.
It was the 80s. He's still doing the same jokes. So,
Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, Christ in heaven.
Can I just say one thing? Mark is not full of shit. God, I wish I'd write something new. Anyway, yeah, you know, it's been a while when you get up there and go, so how about that Reagan? But what I would do, because we literally, Mark, we were in a van and we toured the country. I mean, mostly up New York.
Mostly East Coast.
Mostly East Coast. After you came in, yeah. Before that, we went to St. Louis. We went to Chicago. Were you in Chicago with us? No.
No, 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 no.
And
God, I wish we had some photos.
We literally would go. We were Rhode Island Rhode Island. But you'd go into a town and you would stay in a hotel, and then we'd get in the van in the morning and drive to a school. We'd do a show at the school. We'd put everything back in the van. We'd drive to another school. We'd do another show, and then we'd go back to the hotel. And sometimes those schools were 2 hours apart. Sometimes the school could be 3 hours away from the hotel. So we spent 8-9 hours easy, five of us sitting in that van, trying to find ways to entertain each other. And I got to say, in all honesty, a lot of material, because I wasn't a comic yet, but a lot of times I just say something, you guys would laugh, and I would then incorporate it later when I started doing stand-up.
Yeah.
I mean that. I knew if Doug laughed, it had to be funny.
So Doug, you better hit him up for some writing credit and some.
Yeah. Where's my check?
You get 10% of what I'm making off this show.
Man, how can you divide up nothing?
So you're drinking vodka and some different juices.
Look like polar seltzers?
Yeah, polar seltzer, something like that.
And what do you got, Marky? What do you got?
I am doing the Italiano Nespresso with a little bit of that homemade Kahlua my mom made.
Mark's got a gig tonight. Oh, you got some Kahlua. All right. I, in honor of you, Doug.
Yes.
I went and made myself a martini.
Nice.
Yeah.
Very nice. And That's what took so long.
I'm pouring it now. No, I made it early, and I've had it in the refrigerator, so it's in.
Oh, okay.
And I've had the glass chilling for an hour.
Yeah, I can see it's frosty.
Yeah, I'm not kidding. I'm not joking around here. So cheers, boys.
Cheers.
Yep.
Thank you for doing this.
Cheers. Where's my screen? There we are. Okay.
Oh, that's good. Oh, it's good, Doug. Here's what. I wasn't going to tell this story, but I'm going to tell it. A friend of ours, like a mentor, really, to both of us, who had written that play, Mark, about the drunk drinking and driving, none for the road. He had written he was older than us, and he's he like a father figure to me, and I'm sure to you in a lot of ways, right, Doug?
Yeah.
He had written this musical.
And oh, God.
This is about 16, 17 years ago, and Doug was so hot on Trading Spaces, and he asked us to be in the musical, and he put Doug in the musical in one of the lead roles, and the musical, things were kind of a mess. The musical was great. I thought it was a great show.
I thought it was, too.
Yeah, but it wasn't. We were like, listen, we'll only do this if it's going to be professionally done. But we didn't really feel it was really professionally being done.
I felt like I was doing children's theater.
Yeah, and the guy who wrote it was saying to me, I think Doug's going to quit. Because Doug was, like, hot. I mean, he was a hot name. And he kept saying,
"I think was I on billboards and everything?
You were huge.
At that time? Yeah."
And he's like, "I think Doug might quit. You have to take him out, get him drunk, and keep him in the show." And every night, Doug and I would go out and drink martinis. And after about two martinis, I'd sit there going, "You need to quit." I go, "Dude, if people come to the show and they go, wow, the chubby guy sucked. You know, nobody's gonna care." I go, "But if they go, the guy from Trading Spaces, that's, you can't have that right now." You're
a, no. Well, the character.
In the honor kid, of.
Yes.
And he did quit.
Yeah. And, you know, what was it? Oh, shoot. I lost my track of thought. Anyway.
So
I have an Eddie Mecca story. You brought up Eddie. I was working. I had a restaurant for a while.
You have an Eddie Mecca story.
I had forgotten about it because we were talking about, you know, some people that I met along the way, and I wrote down some names, and I completely forgot about this. There's so many people that I just don't remember. But I had that restaurant in Illinois that I ran and completely gutted a building and designed a restaurant. And I did that for about 3 years. But while I was there, there's also a little theater on the square, which is a equity theater. Small house, but an equity theater. Well, Eddie Mecca and Shirley, what's her name?
Cindy Williams,
yes. They came in and did a show together. It was just the two of them. Can't remember what the name was. But they would come to the restaurant and hang out. As the story goes, when they were in rehearsal, I guess Eddie Mecca sharted. He sharted, and he had to run off stage, go and check himself. He literally brought his underwear back and showed it to Shirley, and you know, everyone on stage. No, it wasn't that much. Can you imagine?
Again, just like Ohio, part of that is the greatest thing I've ever heard and the worst thing I've ever heard. I can't figure out what. Wow, Eddie Mecca.
Eddie Mecca with a little show and tell.
He may or may not have been drinking.
If you remember, Eddie Mecca danced with Madonna in A League of Their Own. Did you see A League of Their Own, the movie?
Yeah, of course.
Laverne, what's her name? Penny Marshall directed it.
Yeah.
And there's a scene where the girls are in a bar and Madonna's dancing and she's dancing with Eddie Mecca.
I'll have to pay attention to that next time I see it.
What play was he doing with Cindy Williams? Do you remember?
I can't remember the play. It wasn't anything that was wildly popular, but it was just a two-person play.
So you built a restaurant pretty much from the ground up.
Yeah, well, I nearly gutted the whole restaurant. I mean, yes, I gutted 90% of it and then built it back up. So, yeah.
Yeah, I remember you were never here. You were never in New York at that time.
Yeah, I was in and out. I was still, like, when I was doing it, I was still shooting my show Moving Up. And also, that was on the tail end of Trading Spaces. I can't remember. Yeah, there was one year where the cast got fired. They didn't hire us back, and they brought in another whole cast. It didn't fly because then they came back and rehired us.
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, I remember that.
Wow. Well,
that was one of the first really big reality shows that I remember. Where, I mean,
it was us and Survivor that really came out kind of at the same time for reality based. But
because I used to tell people you were Simon Cowell before Simon Cowell.
Well, you know, Simon Cowell. Okay, I used to write an article for In Touch Weekly, and it was like celebrity homes, and then I would recommend things to get the look and the feel of what the celebrities have. So everybody from, yes, Madonna to, you know, Simon Cowell. Simon Cowell, this came out of his mouth. Simon Cowell said, well, is he going to be mean to me?
Are you serious?
I'm dead serious.
Because you were always, I used to tell people, I go, you know, my friend is on that show. And people go, which one? I go, Doug, he's the asshole. Because you were so mean.
I was, you know what? I said everything that the viewers wanted to say.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and the viewers loved me because I was honest. I wasn't sugarcoating anything. And, you know, if it was ugly, well, it's ugly. All right, let's fix it. You know, stuck to my guns on design, push the envelope.
Tell the millions of people that are watching right now. because I don't even know this, because you and I weren't really on good terms at the time. How did you get this? How did this come about? I've never asked you this.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Interesting.
You were an actor in New York.
Yeah, I was an actor in New York, but that has nothing to do with how I got the role.
And you had The Handyman. That was the name of your
company. Yeah, I started my career, in New York, washing windows. And then I started a business called Handyman Can and ended up working for interior designers and, you know, renovating homes, painting homes. Not renovating, really, at that time. In fact, Richie, you remember working with me?
No,
I hired Richie.
No, Doug, I forgot. Here's what happened. I'm going to tell you the real story. Here's what happened.
I might embellish.
He's living in Minnesota. I'm going to give you a break here because I think you were going to be nice to me and I wasn't going to let you. He's living in Manhattan and he's got this business and he's got to get his paints and everything from one side of the Manhattan to another side of Manhattan. But he doesn't have a car. Who has a car in Manhattan? Well, who owned a car?
Any comedian you know.
I own a car. So he said to me, hey, man, I really need a car. He said, I'll give you $150 a day if you let me use your car to get around Manhattan to do my work. And I go, well, I'll do you one better. I'll work for you. And he said, then I'll give you $100.
I don't blame you because I guarantee you bring Richie on a job, he's going to tell you you're painting it wrong.
I couldn't do it. Doug,
there was blue tape wrapped all around him all the time. He could not tape a baseboard to save his life. I've never seen anyone so inept as Richie Byrne.
And the one thing Doug did that was amazing, and I've always remembered this, every day he would clean up, even if he wasn't done, he made sure that room was spotless. He would not leave a room unless it was cleaned up, which I thought was cool because people were still living there. And he would be like, all right, can you just vacuum? I couldn't even vacuum market with Farrah. I was like,
Richie's going, bro, the vacuum don't work, bro. I don't know how this vacuum works. Did you hit the power button? I don't know where the power button is, bro. You should have seen Joey trying to walk Richie through getting online.
Oh yeah,
our producer Joey. Oh. He had to send him a laptop computer.
My computer.
What happened to you, Richie? Happened to you?
In 59, you just quit believing in technology.
No, you know what happened?
Computers, bro. These are just fads. Computers aren't gonna last.
I would ask people to show me things online. How to work things. And people would go to show me, and then I would have trouble figuring it out. And they go, let me do it. That was everyone, like every computer nerd, just let me do it. Just let me do it.
So you never learned.
You never learned anything.
You mama's boy.
So like, I'll do it. I'll do it. So I never learned anything. But Doug, we had a lot of good times. We drove up and down in Manhattan. Mark, I used to have to stay at his apartment a lot, and because we'd get up early and go to work. It's every job we did, we got up early, you and me. And mostly with a hangover. And you had a dog, Ice.
Oh, Ice. Oh, Ice. Black Ice. Yeah.
Loved him, dude. And the dog was infatuated with me.
Ice loved you. I don't know why.
I would be on Doug's couch because I was sleeping on the couch. Ice would get on the couch and just stare at me.
His paw.
But then I would stare back, and then after a few minutes, he just casually put his paw on my leg like he was hitting on me.
Hey, Richie, you and I's relationship.
I would take the paw away, and a few minutes later, he'd put the paw back, but he never stopped staring at me. And I miss Ice so much. He was one of my favorites. He was such a...
Richie goes, okay, I'll pet you. And Ice went, yeah, you better heavy pet me.
I will copy one of these really good pictures that I have of him and send to you.
Really? I would love that.
Yeah.
He was one of my, I never had a dog. He was my favorite. One of my favorite dogs. I adored Ice.
Can we get back to me and my story?
Yeah, I'm sorry. thank you. So you were working right. I forget. I'm a half a martini in. I forgot where we were.
God. Yeah. So the handyman and painting. So that then moved into decorative painting because I was going in all these nice, you know, really nice homes and seeing these decorative paint finishes. Well, in high school and college, I worked for an interior designer, silkscreen lithographer, graphic artist, whatever. So I learned a lot of skills in terms of color and how you mix color. And I was like, well, that I can do this. So I ended up doing some paint finishes for interior designers and ended up becoming really well known for it. And I did decorator show houses, Kip Spade decorator show house, so on and so forth. But in the meantime, I was also maintaining Michael Bloomberg's townhouse. I maintained his townhouse on the Upper East Side for about nearly 10 years. Mm-hmm. So I did I did restoration work and repair to paints. I didn't do the original work, but there is one little space that I did something original. But anyway, so I was doing these decorated show houses. Kip Spade decorated show house is the creme de creme of any show house in the country, possibly the world. And I got press in the New York Times for it. And then, you know, I did some other decorated show houses for, you know, designers. You know, I would do the painting for them. But they were leaving me out of the credits, okay, when things went to magazines and such. So I decided to take it upon myself to say, well, screw it. I'll invest in the space and I can decorate it. I can style the space. You know, the first space I had was a vestibule, entry vestibule, right, you know, a small space. And then another space I did was Showcase Home for the Millennium in 1999. And I did this zebra print on the walls, big scale, large scale. sort of like, you know, taking a cue from Ralph Lauren and their ottomans, you know, zebra ottomans and stuff. And then I teamed up with Crate and Barrel, and they gave me all the furniture. And House and Garden magazine wanted to publish it. But my photos weren't up to par for them, and the show house was taken down. So they decided to put me in a color psychology article. And there was a production company down in Knoxville, Tennessee, that they had somebody scouting magazines and so on and so forth, looking for artistic, creative people for this little show that we didn't, it didn't even have a name at the time. And it became Trading Spaces. So I was found, I wasn't cast. Now, most things now, they're cast. You know, you see all these reality shows where, you know, mom, daughter, and mom, and whatever. And I'm not so sure that those girls and whatever are
right,
actually doing what they say they're doing. We were real. And that was the heart and soul of, I think, Trading Spaces, why it became so, you there know, we were not faking it. We didn't know what we were doing. You know, there wasn't, we didn't know what reality based was, because there was no reality based.
Right. Right.
So, and then, yeah, I thought I was going to do it. I'll just get a reel together. Maybe I can like be the Today Show guy, you know, that does right. decorative paint finishes and styles and so on. Well, little did I know. Yeah.
It blew up. It blew up. It was your, we'd go out, Mark, to a bar or something, me, him, and our friend Vince or Jonathan or yeah. and people, it was like being with a rock star. I mean, people were, I had a girl hit on me to get to him. I'm not kidding. And I was laughing my ass off because she was like, pretty much, if you want to go outside for a little, I'm like, he's right here. I'm not his bodyguard. Are you?
I mean, I'm pretty, you know, I have that, you know, image of being like, you know, the mean guy and whatever, but Rich knows this. I mean, he will back me. You know what? It's kind of the opposite of who I am.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can be acerbic and, you know, sarcastic and whatnot, but
a huge dick. You can be a huge dick.
But I'm not mean.
No, you're not. And last year we went out for drinks and a guy came up and was like, I love you, man. Oh, remember? It was me, you, and Vince.
Yeah, yeah.
And the guy was going crazy. And it was so bad. It was great to see. And I love that. I love that. And you were great to him and his wife. And it was really sweet, you know. Now, and you have a big fan. At the time, you had a big fan in someone who I worked with. And I don't know if Mark ever worked with John Stewart.
No, yeah.
John Stewart was a big fan of the show?
Yes, John Stewart. Super fan.
And he had you on the Daily Show?
Yes, I was on The Daily Show. It's my favorite interview I've ever done. He has better
comedic credits than us.
Yeah, he does.
And you know, honestly, that was actually my first talk show interview, and it was the best interview I've ever done, I think.
Really? Well, we have a clip. Let's run the clip.
Oh, okay.
Please welcome Doug Wilson. Doug!
You look like a baby.
How are you? I'm great.
What a baby. Huh?
Did you decorate this?
Huh?
It's good.
Huh?
Nice. The good days. Yes.
It's called. How you doing?
I'm good. I'm good. I just like to come here and drink water.
Have
everybody,
some water.
That's the first thing people do. They come here and they.
That was vodka.
Water.
Come on.
You know what that is? It's a ritual.
I wish.
A talk show. You do that. And then you tell a tremendous anecdote about a woman who wouldn't let you paint her couch. And and then I say when your show is on. Yeah. And then you're like,
I was so nervous.
Miraculous.
I was so nervous.
Thank you. You know what's sad about this is I watch your show, I think, constantly.
That's great. John Stewart was like this huge, you know.
He's fanboying for you.
Yeah. I didn't have to say hardly anything in that interview because he was just so excited about talking about the show.
Well, you know, when I did the Rosie O'Donnell show, he was a guest.
Oh, he was.
And he found out that it was my first national show.
Uh-huh.
And you would have thought it was his. He went berserk. We were in adjoining dressing rooms and he introduced himself to, and It's all he could. He was pulling people in. You know, it's his first big show. Did you know how big this is? Like, he was so excited for me.
You know, he really is a super nice guy.
He's genuine.
I really love him.
And every time, and I had a lot of friends who worked on The Daily Show, so I used to go to The Daily Show a lot. I actually was they talked to me about doing backing up the warm up guy. It just never came about.
Right.
And any time I went there, I would just go, "Hey, John, Richie Byrne," and he go, "Rosie O'Donnell." He remembered. He was such a good guy that way.
That's cool. Yeah.
You know, when this happened, when I got on the John Stewart show, apparently Bill Maher or somebody bailed kind of at the last minute to be on the show. So, of course, you know, they're booking people, put the word out to every network and anyone who's in town. You know, who can we get to replace this? We need him like today, like at 4 o'clock. Okay. And I was actually booked on a flight to LA that afternoon, because I was going to do the finals of, Donny Osmond, $100,000 pyramid. So they ended up changing the network ended up changing my flight so that I could be on the Jon Stewart show or the Daily Show. They also, though, booked at the same time Sam Rockwell. So they didn't want to say no to either of us because they wanted both of us on, because Sam was promoting that Gong Show movie.
Chuck Barris.
Yeah. George Clooney directed it, and then I'm going to veer off to that in a minute. it was funny. Sam went before I did, and he may or may not have been smoking some marijuana before the interview.
No.
And so he's going on this story, talking about, you know, and going up the mountain, and it was like a tangent. Jon Stewart finally is like, "Are you on that mountain right now?" It was actually an uncomfortable, you could feel the audience. The audience was like, kind of, it was a little uncomfortable. So when I came out, you know, it was like, they're like, "Oh, thank God," you know? So then I saw Sam again at the premiere of, what is the name of that movie? Dangerous, what? The Gong Show movie.
Oh, I don't remember the
Chuck
name.
Barris. Yeah, I can't
Chuck
remember.
Barris. Was Chuck Barris claimed to be a spy?
Yeah.
Spy.
Well, that
and it was about him.
That premiere was the first time I walked down the red carpet in L.A. I was with Alex McLeod, the first host of Trading Spaces, but people, you know, don't always remember that we had a host before Paige Davis, Alex McLeod.
Well, Paige, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
No, I didn't know.
Alex McLeod was the first host. She then went on to do the dating show, the first where they gave the rose out. What the hell is that show?
Bachelor?
I don't watch it.
Bachelor.
Yeah, The Bachelor, yeah.
Doug, when I'm reminding you of names, you're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
Stop drinking.
So anyway, that was the first red carpet, and Alex was so mad because we got there a little later than she wanted to, and we went after George Clooney, and she didn't like that. So we had to kind of wait for George to get through the line, and it was so we go through the line. You know, was kind of very nervous about how do you work the camera. Alex will say, we have to look at the same people every time. She was like getting annoyed with me. She was training me. So we go into the party afterwards, and there's, you know, everybody's there. Matt Damon, you know, so on and so forth. And in fact, I was able to go in the VIP room, and I was nervous. Yeah, very nervous. Hadn't been around this type of atmosphere ever.
This is A-list shit now.
Yeah, this is A-list shit. Yeah. So I walk through and I'm seeing all these people, you know, that I know, but, you know, would never say anything to. And I walk back and I'm about ready to walk out, and somebody yells to me, say, "Doug, Doug." And I turn and it's freaking Matt Damon. And he was there with his wife. And he's like, we were just talking about you today. Blah, blah, blah. And he says, sit down. We got to talk to you. You know, so I sat down and talked to them for quite a while. And that was great. And I was dumbfounded because I was like, I knew that like normal people, like, you know,
knew you.
The Midwest knew me, but it never occurred to me that celebrities,
famous people might be watching.
We're watching us.
Right.
You know, and it was like a huge awakening.
Yeah. Well, what is it? The president of TLC, which you were on TLC, right?
TLC. Yeah.
And the president was Dr. Oz's roommate in college.
Yes. Well, he was not the president.
Great guy.
Well, like the CEO, Coach. Shoot, what's his name?
I can't remember his name either, so yeah. I'm not going to be any help. But he was Dr. Oz's roommate in college,
right.
at Harvard. And Doug came to see me at Dr. Oz's show, and Doc knew who you were. He's all, I go, and then you mentioned his roommate, and that was it, Mark. I was out. Doc and Doug like went off together, and then. Nobody had time for me for the rest of the freaking day.
Invited you to the birthday party.
Oh, yeah, I was like left out.
Do you know that that roommate, it's going to kill me. He was on the flight that landed in the Hudson. Sully. Yes, he was on that flight. Yeah.
No, I didn't know that.
We're going to have to put the bird down.
His name. But he's a really nice guy. And yeah. When he comes to the show every once in a while, and we always make fun of you.
he still comes?
Yeah, he comes around. So
great, thanks.
You are in Manhattan right now.
Uh huh.
And you've been dealing with this from Manhattan the whole time.
Yeah, in fact, you know, I was an early quarantiner. And an early mask wearer, to be quite honest. Well, by the time I knew it, like something told me I need to go get masks. Okay, go to Janovic or go to wherever. And then I wasn't able to do it that day. Well, then the next day, everything was gone. And I'm like, I've got my mask that I use for painting somewhere. So I dug it out. Yeah.
And do you really go outside like that? Put the picture up again, Joey.
Yes.
Luke, I am your father.
Jesus.
And I try to make it look as weird as possible.
Well, you got to.
Good job. Good job. Now, how are things there? Is it really?
Well, it is. You know, there's all these people out there that are like, you know, the conspiracy theorists and whatnot, that this isn't really what it is. I'm like, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
How can you even believe that?
Even in New York City? Because I understand that on the outskirts of the
I think on the outskirts. I don't think not in New York City.
Yeah, New York, pretty much. Yeah.
I have a lot of friends who keep saying that it's not real and that kind of stuff. And I'm like, all right, this summer you're coming to a lot of funerals with me.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I do a weekly check-in with my hometown, Champaign, Illinois, University of Illinois, TV station there, WCIA, a show called CI Living. So every Tuesday, I have a standing taping with them, and I give them an update on what's going on in the city from my perspective, and what I'm doing to just, you know, keep occupied. And Monday, I went down to Lenox Hill Hospital because I'm tired of these people like, oh, this is not real. And I videoed the semis, not to get too dark here, but, you know, this is reality. The two semi-trailers that were back-to-back with a tent in between and the tents, you know, going into the doorway of Lenox Hill to camouflage all of the body bags that are going into those freezer trucks. Yeah, it's really, and then they also had some footage from Potter's Island where, you know, the trenches are being made and they're stacking wooden boxes of bodies in these trenches because, you know, they just,
that's all they can do. More than anything is how quiet it is. It's New York City and it's just quiet.
Isn't it eerily quiet? This I sent you. Afternoon on a work day. And that's Third Avenue at 76th Street. I mean,
you can't even drive a car up that street during the day. No. It's so bad.
No, no. But it's a different time, and I don't know what's going to happen. And I don't want to dwell on this too much, but I think it's really going to change how we live in the future. And I think that we're going to, it's going to change, how we interact with people. It's going to, hygiene is going to be something that we're very concerned with, washing our hands.
That's a positive.
I look like Pig Ben,
but I smell like soap. All right.
But speaking from the entertainment industry side, reality-based TV came out, and I was a part of that, and the networks were like, oh, you mean we can just have regular people on and not pay them and then, not have a studio and use people's homes or just wherever they are and save hundreds of thousands of dollars? Well, now what's happening? We're seeing, like we're doing right now.
Yeah, this is...
Taping in our own homes. Yeah. So I think, besides, flying people here and there, I think companies are going to look at this as, well, it worked during coronavirus. You know what? Why can't it work,
I think a lot's going to change. Yeah. You're a big theater guy. That's we met doing theater.
Yes. Yeah.
What do you think happens with the Broadway shows? I mean, do you have an opinion on this? And I
don't think Broadway is going to change because, you can go see a movie of a Broadway show. But people always want to see live theater. They're always going to want to go to a live concert. There's certain things that you have to have.
Yeah, I understand. Do you think...
Unless Richie's on the show.
Thank you. Do you think that any of the shows... Because I'm starting to worry about this. Do you think that any of the shows that were running when this hit can handle it and be running when we come back?
I think we are going to lose some shows. The shows that were maybe just kind of hanging on.
I'll give you, because a friend of mine's wife is the producer, and it's Hadestown, which is a big hit.
Oh, we have Patrick Page's husband is there. Yeah,
Davis's husband is the star.
Yeah, he was up for a Tony.
I ran into him in the street after he got after they got all the Tony nominations.
Right.
And
yeah.
I went to the show with Joel, our producer, and Gino from Gino's Cheesesteaks, who Gino, who's very good friends with Mark, by the way. And and after the show, we go outside, and who's getting a cab? But Paige's
Patrick
up.
Page.
And we were like, "Hey, great show, Pat. Oh, thanks." Blah blah blah. Then, a month later, I'm walking down the street to go do a show at Sirius Radio, and who's getting in a cab? Patrick. And I go, "Hey, man, congrats on the Tony." He's like, "Thank you." I'm like, "I don't even know this guy, but he keeps popping up in my." He must be like, "Who is this guy? Why does this guy keep showing up?"
That's funny.
And then I did that same week. I had to fill in at Rachel Ray, and Paige was the guest.
Yeah.
And I said to her, I go, "I keep running into your husband on the street." And she was like, "Oh, you're the guy joking." And then I told her that I was good friends with you. And she said, "Whatever you do, don't tell him I'm here."
Why is that?
She was just kidding.
Maybe that's a sign that there's a threesome in the cards for the three.
Me and Patrick and Paige.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, Doug. What would I do? You might know a little more about that than me. What are you doing? Are you eating the sandwich? What are you doing?
No, I'm pouring
myself making a drink.
I'm doing a refill.
And what is that noise? There's like
me refilling, you know, the drink.
We
never told a joke, did we?
No. I guess we're going to be closing the show.
Here's the deal, Doug. The name of the show.
No. We have so much more to talk about.
I know. Well, here's the fucked up thing about you, Doug Wilson.
Yeah.
There's a lot, but I'm gonna tell our audience this. We do the podcast before we were live video. We used to do the podcast at the comic strip. They had a podcast studio, and the comic strip is not far from where Doug lives.
Yeah, it's right there.
I used to say, Doug, come do the podcast. And you always had a reason you couldn't do it. Oh, I can't. Now we got you on. We had to go to your home to get you. And now you're like, I don't want to stop. This is too much fun. And I told you it would be fun. But that's why we named the show Drinks, Jokes, and Storytelling. So we always start the show with a drink, obviously.
Right.
Then we tell a joke, but we got you on and we forgot to tell the joke.
Okay. Well, is it gonna be any good?
Yeah, if I can remember it. I was gonna tell it an hour ago. Oh, I got it. But let's go out with it. Doug, I feel like I want to talk more, but we usually get out at this time.
Well, you know what?
We have to have you back on.
Would you come back on?
Yeah, what the hell else do I have to do right now?
You know what? It's quotes like that that make us feel really wanted. What the hell else am I doing?
Yeah, I guess I'll come on your show at the end of the world and then ding dong. Hey! We're ready. We got the cameras.
Okay, you bring me back for the 100th.
We're going to talk when we finish the show. Don't go off. Stay on. We're going to be backstage. We'll talk.
Okay.
We'd love to have you on for the 100th.
That'd be awesome.
You should have a few people on for the 100th.
That's our goal, to have rotating cast.
We're way ahead of you.
You're a dick burn.
All right. So here's my joke. You ready? Oh, we didn't even talk about Hollywood Squares.
Oh, yeah. Hollywood, oh my God.
Squares.
Well, do you want to save that for next time?
Yes.
We'll save it for next time.
Yeah. Okay.
And Lindsay Lohan.
Lindsay Lohan.
We've got so much more on the table.
I knew this.
Cliffhanger. Anyone listening, make sure you tune back in because we're going to have Doug back on and you're going to hear.
We're going to have a brand new sandwich. All right. So here's the joke and then we'll go out. 60-year-old woman's walking down the street.
Is that you?
I like Doug a lot.
You know what? You're going to ruin the joke. I actually should go out on that. That was pretty funny.
Yeah, I think my punchline is going to be better than the joke.
You know what? That was funny.
All right. So real quick, the show's going to end on a video. This video about 8 years ago, there was a viral video where people were putting people's faces in birthday cakes while they were singing Happy Birthday.
I forgot about that. We could have saved it.
Ah, we'll have it on right now, and then we'll go into the green room.
Doug, you have been a great guest. This is our we didn't even tell you this is our Showbiz Thursdays. So we do every Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, we have a comedian on. Mondays we do coronavirus guests. It's been pretty interesting. We have doctors,
nurses.
Yeah, and then we decided because we wanted to split it up. We didn't want to just do five comics a week. So we said, let's do show business people on Thursdays. So you're actually our first show biz guest.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm sure you don't want to be saturated with Trading Spaces, but Paige just did an interview with CI Living, my hometown station, where I check in every week. Mm-hmm. And they're interviewing a lot of other people because they want to get perspective of how celebrities are hunkering down. I mean, I'm sure Paige would do this if you wanted her.
We'd love that. We'd love that, Paige.
That'd be great.
Yeah, that would be great. And maybe her husband could go, I know that guy.
Have him get a cab on the show.
The funny thing is, I said, well, maybe you and Patrick could do it. Patrick couldn't be bothered with it. I don't think he likes to do like any sort of social media. I mean, I think it's hard for him. He just wants to act, I think.
I know, but he's sitting home.
Yeah, bye. Well, you know what? I don't know.
Maybe he can come on in character.
He was great. Did you see the play?
No.
Oh my. Who, me? Doug?
Yeah, I didn't.
I saw it with Paige. She made sure she got me some good house seats, and we watched it together.
Oh, it was tremendous, and he was phenomenal.
I haven't seen something like that. And okay, I haven't seen Hamilton, believe it or not, I have not seen a musical that was so powerful,
yeah,
and artistically, you know, perfection.
And my friend Seth Meldman, who you've met, he was the stage manager at Dr. Oz. His wife is the producer. Mara is the producer of.
Dude,
I've been hearing about this play for 7 years. She had it in workshops. She had it in England. Yeah. She had it on the West. And I've been hearing about it. Because we were good friends. Hey, this is happening with the play. So bang, the play hits. It's a huge success. She's going up every 2 minutes. Do you want to hear a funny story? She's going up every 2 minutes to get another award at the Tonys.
Uh-huh.
And she gave a great speech at the Tonys. And Seth, her husband, is one of the stage managers for the Tonys. He's not in a tux. He's in dark clothes. He's working for the Tonys. You didn't take the night off. So I can't stop thinking about them and, you know, how much this meant to her. A labor of love this was for her to get this show off the ground and going. And then it becomes the biggest hit. And then, bang, this happens, you know?
Yeah.
It's just
I think Hadestown is going to be fine. Wicked's going to be fine. You know, all those big guys are going to be fine.
Make sure you support Broadway when you can, man. Seriously.
Yeah.
When I'm talking to the audience. Go see shows. It's a great night out. People don't realize what a great night out it really is. So.
Yeah.
And we the next time we have you on, Doug, we've got to get rid of whatever the chains are that you're tied to here.
The chains? What?
Move your hand. Move your arm. What's making that noise?
What noise?
That. You hear that noise? Shake hard. What is that?
It's my shirt. That's the only thing making sounds right now.
Richie. Let's cut out on the
video. Wait. Tomorrow, 8 o'clock, Don Jameson.
The great Don Jameson.
Don Jameson from...
That metal show, that metal Beer show. Money.
Good friend of both of us, really good friend of Mark's. Doug Wilson, you have been just so great. So great. And we're going to have you back in the next few weeks because we do have a lot more to talk about.
Well, I just say, Mark, you have been great. Thank you so much. Richie. Thank you.
Hey everybody, I'm Mark. This here's Jason. You're watching Pinked. Today on Pinked, we're gonna pink our friend. He's the douchebag looking guy with his sleeves rolled up.
We're totally gonna get him.
Yeah,
right. Watch. Follow us. Come on.
Thank you guys. Thank you so much. This is great.
All right. Happy.
Last call.
Thanks for listening to Drinks, Jokes, and Storytelling.